Today I thought I'd bring you something different. We've just finished our second season of Oil and Gas. As you know, we began the first season in July last year, and we're going to look back on the first season. We started this Oil and Gas series by going first to government. We spoke to government, we spoke to private sector, we spoke to the community. We picked a variety of perspectives, but we began with GNPC.
What is the strategic vision?
I want to build GNPC into an integrated, a world-class integrated oil and gas company, like Petrobras that I mentioned.
That's right.
Like the PDVSA.
Yes. Is that the good way? Is it? That must be deliberate. I mean, why do you opt for that?
Well, for me, that is a good way. A world-class oil and gas organization. Yes. That is what it is.
Yes. But I'm interested in ownership. Is that important?
Eventually, we could go private. Yes. Eventually, GNPC could go private. Could, that we have the flexibility. We have the flexibility to do the kind of things that we need to do.
It was good to start the series by going to GNPC, the lead government agency. And right from the beginning, I got a feeling that there was a bit of a gap between what they wanted to do and what they were capable of doing at the time.
It takes about $50 million to drill a deep water well. And given the financial circumstances of GNPC at that time, we could not do it. And that is why it was appropriate for us to promote these prospects to the companies who would team up with us to drill the prospect, to drill them with their risk capital. A national oil company like GNPC, given our resources at that time, you see, and given the fact that we did not have the technical capability and financial capability, was it proper for us to risk that amount of money given the cost of well drilling?
How do you feel about the state of things now, and what would you like to see happen?
I'm very happy to start with, but at the same time, there are certain challenges that we need to tackle. Such as the development of capacity. You see,
for example, you are fearful that we don't have enough people to.
No, for example, you see, to develop the phase one development alone will cost about $4.2 billion.
The Jubilee Field, is that the Jubilee Field?
Yes.
$4.2 billion to develop the field.
Exactly.
When you say to develop, you mean to begin to extract oil?
Extract oil and all those. Okay. How much of this investment will remain in the country?
So that is your main concern?
Yeah.
Please.
One of them.
Of them. What is your other concern?
The other concern is that for GNPC, we have not been into development of this huge assets before. So what do we need to put in place?
To put in place for what?
No. You see, you're going to have so many challenges now. You're going to have production coming on stream. Do you have the right caliber of people? Do you have the right processes and procedures in place? You see, all these are things that GNPC is quickly developing right now to be able to respond to these challenges.
GNPC cannot do this alone, and this highlights the need for a partnership.
Right. We have good partners?
So we have very good partners. We have very good working relationships. Of course, partnerships within in families,
have
amongst
challenges.
Men, you know, husbands and wives, there are challenges.
Well, all was not well, that's the feeling I got, and I suspected that he was talking about Cosmos Energy. But let's move on to the bigger picture.
Have we struck a fair production deal? I mean, the relationship with the companies that will exploit this resource. What kind of a production arrangement do we have?
We committed to working with our partners, and we committed to ensuring that we create the necessary environment for them. We will protect their investments into this arena, but we also make sure that at the end of it all, it is a win-win.
We've had gold for 100 years, if not more. And we know the story, Dr. Otingeje. I mean, people do not necessarily feel that we have benefited from our gold resource. How is this different to our problems?
I think that we are in a different generation altogether. You and I have had opportunities to study outside. You and I have had opportunity to stay outside. And we've come back home with a commitment that never again to sell natural resources to investors without ensuring that our people also benefit.
never again. I mean, never again was a recurring theme throughout the year. It was quite clear that there were many parties that didn't feel quite satisfied with the sort of benefits we derive from the extractive industry. So I proceeded to find out, I mean, what's in it for us?
It would depend on the oil prices. It would depend on the oil.
No, but percentage-wise, what did we get?
Percentage-wise, we are going to get about, starting from 56% of net oil, rising as profitability goes up to about 67% of net oil.
How? How are we?
Net oil, meaning that if you take the cost of development from it, the profit that is left will be shared in that proportion.
We will get the majority.
Exactly.
I was astonished. 67% would come to Ghana. I mean, up to that point, my understanding was that all we got was 10%. Are we missing something here? Back in a moment.
Better than honey on bread, better than champagne and pretzels, better than breakfast in bed, better than chili rellenos, better than chocolate eclairs, better than hot house tomatoes, better than fresh Bartlett pears, better than dining a la carte, or simply gastronomic art, better than anything except being in love.
Water from the bosom of nature, the real naturally no water, undergoes ecology and good filtration. Check the looks, and stylish and trendy. Fresh air and cool, not a mean of water, deep, deep down from the bowels of my nature. It's fresh and cool and nice. The real not a mean of water.
Get your refreshment from the real natural mineral water. Safina, the real natural mineral water. Safina.
Are you in need of credible and relevant business information to make vital decisions? Or do you wish to reach Ghana's upmarket business and consumer segment with your product and services? Subscribe to and advertise in Business and Financial Times today, Africa's leading source of credible and relevant business information. For enquiries, contact 021-785-3667 or visit www.thebftonline.com.
In July last year, there was concern about social upheaval in the coastal communities. And I spoke to Ibu Ferguson, a community relations consultant who lived in Nigeria for many years. He lived in the Niger Delta area. And he had some really startling things to say. I mean, should we take him seriously or is he just a scaremonger?
Port Harcourt, which is the center of the oil industry, is just like Takoradi. When we went there more than 20 years ago, the place was as cool, enjoyable like Takoradi. The people were as free and hospitable like the people of Western region, the people of the whole Ghana. They were ordinary people. Now, 20 years after, they are wielding guns, kidnapping people, fighting among themselves and stopping the oil from flowing.
You know, we describe ourselves as peace-loving people. So often people say, I mean, David, what happened in Nigeria or happen somewhere in Liberia, it's not going to happen in Ghana. Ghanaians don't, they're not violent people. What you're saying is that is neither here nor there.
Yeah, what I'm saying is that the same Ghanaians are saying that if you push a dumb person to the wall, he talks.